إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهدي ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا عما بعد قال الله تعالى في قرآن الحكيم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما صدق الله المولانا العظيم ورفعنا بالقرآن الحكيم. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam and in humanity, we have gathered yet once again on this blessed day of gathering for the prayer of gathering in order to bring our hearts and our souls together to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator and the sustainer, the nurturer and the nourisher of the heavens and the earth and every living organism in this entire universe. We come together to call upon the most beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Asma'ul Husna, chief among them being the merciful and the compassionate Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, and being the most generous Al-Kareem, being the all-loving Al-Wadud, being the most kind Ar-Ra'uf, being the most just Al-Adl, but whose justice is not devoid of any of those qualities. And therefore, my brothers and sisters, we bear witness with full clarity in our hearts and full clarity on our tongues that there is no deity worthy of worship except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Alone is He in His sovereignty, in His oneness, in His absolute perfection, in His great majesty, and in His beauty. And we bear witness that our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came as a wave of mercy for all of the worlds, and that truly he was the best of Allah Ta'ala's creation and is the guide for human beings till the end of time. And we send our peace and our blessings upon him as the final messenger of God and upon his family and companions. My dear brothers and sisters, today in this blessed time that we have together, in which we are accompanied in ranks upon ranks by the invisible angels that join the worshipers and devotees of God wherever they find them on earth, and whose presence I hope we feel in this moment, the blessing of their presence we feel in this moment. That as we gather in this space today, I want to speak about one of the most beautiful and one of the most important virtues that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoins upon humanity, and that was embodied in its most perfect form by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I speak of no other virtue than the virtue of Sidq, the virtue of truthfulness, the virtue of truthfulness. When we were together last week, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever was here, you may remember that the khutbah was about humility in an age of arrogance. And one of the premises of speaking about humility is that it is an always important virtue for Muslims to reflect upon, but that it is even more important for us to reflect upon a virtue like humility in an age in which arrogance is being treated as an aspirational quality, and that people have made the case that in order to be a firm leader, in order to be a strong leader, you should be boastful and arrogant. And in this age, we have to remind ourselves of humility, even if we're opposed to arrogance, because that arrogance might seep into our consciousness in ways that are subtle and in ways that are harmful to us and our souls. And I will begin with that same premise here today, that on the face of it, if you speak to any human being about the virtue of truthfulness, about the virtue of sidq, no one will argue with you. No one will argue with you. You can speak to anyone of any religion, of any background, and on the face of it, they will agree with you that this is a virtue, and perhaps it is one of the greatest virtues, to be a person of truthfulness, to speak that which is right and true. And yet, because of the socio-political ecosystem in which we are living in today, we have to be very careful about the effects that it has, the toxic effects that it has on our souls and on our consciousness, even our subconsciousness, in which now we are being told that there is such a thing as alternative facts, alternative truths. That there's no such thing as, you know, forget about there being such a thing as truth with a capital T. People abandoned that idea a long time ago. But now we are being told that there's no such thing as even truth with a small T. That there are alternative truths, right? And that you can dispute facts that are based in absolute nothing, right? And this age is an age in which people have become so comfortable with lying, with deception, with speaking in a way that deceives their own souls and deceives other people's, and causes mass chaos to occur in the world because of it. It's very interesting nowadays, if you go to New York Times online, they pull up an advertisement, they want you to subscribe to the New York Times. And the first word that comes up, and you can try this yourself, it comes up as truth. Hard to find these days. Right? They're making a commitment to truth because it's hard to find these days. And to me, it's really sad that people have to advertise truth as being something that is rare. You know, now people are advertising truth as if they're advertising gold or some sort of unique gem. Right? Because there's this loss of a commitment to sidq, to truthfulness and to truth. And so as believers in this day and age, my brothers and sisters, we have to really examine our souls and our character, and we have to shun falsehood. We have to shun lying. We have to shun the qualities of hypocrisy that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam spoke of. He said that the hypocrites, they have three qualities. That when they speak, they lie. When they make an oath or a pledge, they break it. And when they become angry or incensed, they start to use foul language. That these are all things that have to do with the tongue, and these are all things that have to do with the trustworthiness of a person, and it goes to the very heart of the character that we must aspire to, the quality and the character of sidq, of truth. And it should suffice us to know that our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, before he was known as a Nabi, he was known as an Amin, which means the trustworthy one. That this was his rank and this was his title before he was a prophet. It was a precondition It was a precondition for him to be able to be a prophet, and it was a precondition for him to be able to speak truth to his people. And what's very interesting about Al-Amin, our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that if you look at it, if you look at all of the arguments of his enemies, if you look at all of the propaganda of his enemies, they said many things, many hurtful things about the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. But one thing that they could never say is that he was a liar. One thing that they, in their own tongue, could not utter about the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam was that he was a liar. They could not say that because they knew that he was impeccable in his truth-telling. And so that even when Abu Sufyan, who was at that time a disbeliever, came before Heraclius, who was sent a letter from the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam inviting him to Islam, and Abu Sufyan was on a caravan and he was called to the court of Heraclius and he was asked, tell me about this man. He said that this man, he tells the truth. This man, he tells the truth. And at this time, he's a disbeliever. He's not even someone who's accepted the shahada of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. My brothers and sisters, in this age, we can talk a lot about the virtue of truth. But we also know that truthfulness is something that is not always easy to live up to. That it is sometimes difficult to tell the truth. That there are situations and circumstances in which telling a lie, speaking falsehoods, is much easier. And in fact, many of us will develop speaking lies from a young age. Why? Because we see the reaction of elders, that if you tell the truth, you get in trouble. Right? But if you speak a falsehood or you deceive your way out of it, then you're free from any sort of punishment. Right? And so we're constantly head faking our way to the basket. And that might be a good basketball move, but it's a poor way of living. And this becomes part of who we are, that we're constantly head faking our way through life. Not speaking the truth because we think that it will get us in trouble. And those of us who are responsible over our own hearts and souls and over the hearts and souls of young people, one of the commitments that we should make is that if you tell me the truth, there might be consequences, because there has to be consequences, but we will find a way out. We will work on this together. You will not be in a situation where you will later regret having told the truth ultimately. And in this moment, I want to share with you, as a really incredible, mind-blowing example of this entire idea, I want to share with you the story of one of the great Sahaba by the name of Ka'ab ibn Malik. Ka'ab ibn Malik, one of the great Sahaba of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, was a poet in the community. He was a poet of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He was somebody who had great rank among the other Sahaba. He was respected very much. When the migration happened, Ka'ab, who was relatively poor before the migration, he became somebody who was quite wealthy when they made the migration to Medina. And when the military expedition of Tabuk came around, which was one of the later military expeditions in which the community had grown in large numbers by that time, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said that all male able-bodied people should come out in strength to defend the community at this time. And by Ka'ab's own admission, he says that at that time in my life, there was no one stronger than myself and no one more affluent than myself in that city of Medina. This is his own words. And one of the reasons that people were trying to find a way out of getting out of this responsibility that the Prophet ﷺ had laid upon them was because the community was so large at that point that people thought they could get away with it if they didn't go. That the Prophet ﷺ would not even notice because there were so many people at this point. I'm going to pause and I'm going to ask my brothers, please move in. Make space for your brothers. And Allah Ta'ala will make space for you in His garden. Make space for each other, and Allah Ta'ala will make space for you in His garden. And so, in this moment, there were people who were trying to get out of the expedition. And there were some people, including Ka'ab, who was on the fence. And he was primarily on the fence because at this point, he had a lot to lose. He had a lot of land, he had a lot of wealth, you know. And when you have all these attachments to the dunya, you have a lot to lose when the Messenger of God is saying, come out and defend the community. So he's constantly on the fence. And he says, according to his own words, that he's procrastinating about the situation. He's constantly going back and forth. He's making some preparations and then he stops. Until finally, when he makes a determination to go out and to join the Prophet ﷺ in the military expedition, he sees, much to his own grief, that the expedition has already left and that he is behind. And he says that he begins to weep and he's full of grief. And a few days later, after the expedition of Tabuk, when the word comes back to the people of Medina that the Prophet ﷺ and the people are coming back to Medina, he becomes full of anxiety that what will he say to the Messenger of God sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he started to seek the advice of all of the wise people, and he started to seek the advice of all of his family, and he was very anxious about this. And there were other people who did not go on this expedition even though they could have. And they made the determination that when the Prophet ﷺ would come, they would sit before him and they would tell him a lie. They would say, I couldn't go because of X, Y, and Z reason. And they knew that the generosity of the Prophet ﷺ was one that he would just let them go. But I want to read to you when the Prophet ﷺ comes and Ka'ab ibn Malik comes before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. These are the words that he speaks. And this should remind us of the great virtue of sidq, of truth, even when it's difficult to tell the truth. Ka'ab radiallahu anhu, he says, when I greeted him, meaning the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, he replied with an angry smile and said, come forward. I walked towards him and sat down in front of him. I want you all to imagine this scene. He then asked me, what kept you back? Didn't you already purchase your camel? I replied, O Messenger of Allah, by Allah, had I been sitting in front of anyone else beside you, I would have been able to escape from his anger by offering an excuse, as I have been blessed with eloquence. But by Allah, I know for a fact that if I were to offer a false excuse to you today by virtue of which you will be pleased with me, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will soon make you angry with me by exposing my wrong to you. And if I were to speak the truth to you, you will become angry with me, but I hope that Allah will be pleased with me for speaking the truth to you. I had no excuse for remaining behind. By Allah, my situation was such that no one was stronger or more affluent than me at the time when I remained behind from you. This is God just pouring out his soul, just telling it like it is, and hoping that the truth will set him free, as it says in the Bible. And so in this moment, what happens? What happens is that the Prophet ﷺ, all the other people who had come and offered their excuses, even though the Prophet, peace be upon him, knew that they were lying and he knew that they were hypocrites, He said, go, be on your way. Ma'adash, no problem. When it came to Ka'ab, he said, go away until I receive some revelation from Allah. And for 50 days, 1 month and 10 days, no revelation came about the matter. And Ka'ab was alienated from the community. The Prophet ﷺ instructed that he should be boycotted, that no one should speak to him, that even his family members should not speak to him. And Ka'ab says that it is like the earth became strange to me. Ka'ab says that this vast earth became something like it was suddenly very narrow for me. And he was full of grief about his situation. And at this time, his former tribe, they came to him and they said, Ka'ab, why should you be treated with such disrespect? You are a noble person, you are a wealthy person, you've done so much for this community. Come with us, we will make you a leader from among our people. These are people who wanted to rile him up against the Prophet ﷺ. But despite the difficulty of that moment, he said, no, I only desire to be with the Prophet ﷺ. And Ka'ab says that he would go for the prayer. He would go for the prayer. And he would try to stand next to the Prophet ﷺ. And that after each of the prayers, he would try to just get the glance of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He would just hope that the Prophet would look toward him. And on one incident, he even saw that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam saw him, but there was so much disappointment in his face. And he was full of grief. But eventually, my brothers and sisters, after 50 days of this, of going through this experience, a revelation came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it vindicated Ka'ab ibn Malik and two or three of the other companions who had done the same thing. And there's a man who came and he said, Ka'ab, good news! A revelation has come, or rather he said, good news, the Prophet ﷺ is letting you free, that he's removing this embargo from you. And look at this, at that moment, despite everything that he went through, he asked the man, he said, is it the messenger of God, or is it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That for him it wasn't sufficient that the Prophet was letting go. Did God forgive him? That was his concern. And when the man said, yes, there's been revelation, then it says in the hadith that he took off his clothes. In such joy, he took off his clothes and he gave it to the man as a gift. Right? That this is how joyous he was about the situation. And then he comes back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he says these beautiful words. He says, when I sat down in front of him, I said, O Messenger of Allah, part of my repentance is that I will give some of my wealth and charity to Allah and His Messenger. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, retain some of your wealth as that will be better for you. I said, I will retain my share that I received from Khaybar. I then said, O Messenger of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved me on account of my honesty. And part of my repentance is that I will speak nothing but the truth for the rest of my life. By Allah, I do not know of any Muslim who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed with anything higher than what he bestowed me since the day I mentioned this to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. By Allah, I never intended speaking a lie ever since I said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam until this day, and I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect me from speaking lies for the remainder of my life as well. Subhanallah al-Azim. That this story of Ka'ab should make us reflect on how important it was to this man to gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is no doubt, my brothers and sisters, that there is no way to gain a greater pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than by committing ourselves to sidq, to truthfulness. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this gorgeous ayah, in Surah Al-Ahzab, in Surah number 33, in verse number 70, in an ayah that is recited at the beginning of many khutbat from the pulpits throughout the world, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. O you who believe, be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and speak with a will to bring out only what is right and true and just. This idea of sadida, my brothers, move in. This idea of sadida is a beautiful word. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the most beautiful words in the Quran. Sadida is a word that means a saying that hits the mark. You know, like when an arrowsman goes and he tries to hit the mark, when they exactly hit the mark, that's sadida. That when it's accurate, when it's on point, right? And At-Tabrisi, who is one of the great commentators of the Quran, he says that sadida means enjoins testifying truthfully. That when you make testimonies, that you're truthful. Speaking in a manner that is upright, that is free from any corruption. And speaking so that the outward meaning corresponds with the inward meaning. That what you intend inside is what you speak outside. And what you should intend inside is, of course, something that is good. And I will leave you in this first part of the khutbah, my brothers and sisters, by sharing with you two very beautiful hadith from the Prophet ﷺ about sidq. The first is that the Prophet ﷺ said, truthfulness leads to righteousness. And righteousness leads to paradise. A person habitually speaks the truth until he is recorded as a very truthful person in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Falsehood leads to evil, and evil leads to the hellfire. A person habitually speaks lies until he is recorded as a grave liar in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To be from among the truthful people, as-siddiqun, is one of the greatest ranks. It is a rank that is mentioned in the Quran alongside the prophets and the martyrs and the righteous. So this is not only something that we do, but it becomes part of our character. And when it becomes part of our character, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala marks us as being people of truth, which is ultimately what our goal must be. And truthfulness is not only eschewing lies, but truthfulness is also speaking that which is right when it is difficult. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ said that the greatest jihad, afdalul jihad, is to speak the truth, kalimatul haqq, in front of the tyrannical king, Sultan in Jair. That this is the greatest jihad, because it is very difficult to do that. It is very difficult to do that. There are heavy consequences. And lastly, the Prophet ﷺ said, truthfulness brings peace to the mind, whereas falsehood constantly causes one to be in a state of anxiety and doubtfulness. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this peace to our minds and to our hearts and to our souls. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among the truthful ones. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us committed to this great virtue of truth. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from falsehood and from lying. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the temptations of our times and from the falsities of our times. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to be risen on the Day of Judgment as people of truth and to enter His garden in Jannat al-Firdaus as people of truth. Let us ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, for truly He is the one who forgives. Astaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين على سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. My dear brothers and sisters, I want to conclude this khutbah by mentioning something that is very important. Last week, we spoke about the virtue of humility, and today we spoke about the virtue of truth and truthfulness. But I also want to leave with this idea or thought, which is very important, that the ethical system and the ethical universe of Islam is something that is very beautiful, and it is something that is very intricately designed, such that even when we speak of the greatest virtues, one of the important things to keep in mind is that there are exceptions even to those virtues, because they are intermarrying with other virtues in the ethical system of Islam. And so constantly there is this sense that yes, humility is an absolute essential virtue of the Muslim, but we are also told in our tradition that the only way to address the arrogant is by faking arrogance, because that's the only language that they understand. And in fact, we also understand that there's a difference between arrogance and being proud. And even though we aspire to be people of humility, we also have to be people who are proud of being Muslim, proud of our religion, proud of our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, proud of this way of life. So that when the Muslims would go around the Kaaba in devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the men in particular were told to leave one arm out, the right arm out, from the ihram, in order to show the strength of the community. You know, to be like, don't mess with us, right? There was this idea that we are a community that cannot be infringed upon. We are not a community that can be humiliated, even though we aspire to the virtue of humility, that there's a big difference between humility and being humilified, right? So that is important for us to keep in mind. Also when it comes to the virtue of truth, that with the virtue of truth, there are in fact times in which it is permissible to speak something which is not entirely accurate. For example, if somebody asks you about something that only should be between you and Allah, you have no responsibility to tell that person the truth, because that is between you and Allah has covered you. So why are you going to confess what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has covered for you? Another instance is that if somebody comes and they try to, if there's a tyrannical king or someone else who tries to come and tries to find out about innocent people and so on and so forth, you can absolutely be deceptive, because one of the greater virtues in Islam is to protect the innocent, right? So it's important for us to have knowledge of our sacred tradition, because the ethical system of Islam is beautiful. It's also intricate, and it's also something that allows us to be informed about what the right action is in the right circumstance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for wisdom. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness when we fall short. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to aspire to these great virtues and to make us people who embody these great virtues. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from all evil and to protect us from all harm. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to His light and to guide us to the greatest of rewards, especially the reward of Jannat al-Firdaus. وصلى الله على سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا وأقم الصلاة. Let us pray.